Hey, what's up, guys, and welcome to the Sunday Debate. It is the Sunday, the 11th of August, and your weekend is officially over. Not sure if the Carte Blanche music is played because usually they go on later these days. But welcome to the show, and thank you so much for tuning in. Tonight we are talking gun control. We're talking about guns in South Africa, and I've got Rowan Heiberg or Heiberg from GOSA, a representative of GOSA here. How's it going?
Although thanks for having us back on the show.
Oh, thanks for coming. And then we've got the lefty, the usual lefty, Gary Kukumur. How's it going?
How's it, Ronaldo? Happy to stand in for the entire left front.
Yeah, I know you have to represent. Nobody else wants to come onto the show, so I suppose you have to represent. But thanks for coming on. I really do appreciate it, guys. Before we start this discussion, I just want to say to everybody that's watching, thanks for tuning in. Something new has happened this Sunday. Super chat's available. So if you guys want a question answered, I've got this policy with regards to my YouTube channel now that Super Chat's enabled, that no matter where we are, what we're talking about, if you've got a question relating to the topic, you're more than welcome to donate and I will work it into the conversation. Doesn't mean that people that are asking their questions, free of charge won't get answered, but when you do a Super Chat, it pops up so it stands out and it's easy to see. So with that being said, let's start this discussion. So I will admit that I am a firearm owner in South Africa, so there might be a little bit of a, aspect of a bias from coming from my side. But I do think that it's an interesting conversation to have, especially considering that there is this clear split in South Africa where people believe that firearms is good. It means that you've got a means of protecting yourself. And then we've also have people on the opposite spectrum that completely sees it as a liability in South Africa, and that if we had to get rid of guns, that will solve the problem in South Africa. So I suppose I will start with Rowan to just explain, why do you support guns? And then I will ask the same, or then I will ask the same question for Gary to say, why do you oppose guns to an extent? I'm not saying that you oppose guns completely, but just your philosophy on it.
Well, Ronaldo, yeah. Well, I think it is best. Somebody used a quote, a firearm is the great equalizer. It is one of the very few ways where a person who is at a disadvantage, whether it be from an age, physical perspectives, or whatever, have a practical way of having an effective method of self-defense. And unfortunately, ideally, one would like it to be something that isn't necessary, but unfortunately, we live in a society where there are people that's hell-bent on evil. And I, for one, would l like, if I die, I want to die at old age, not bleeding out in the floor, hoping I made a plan.
For sure. Gary?
Yeah, thanks, Ronaldo. And look, I'm not. There's three possibilities in this scenario. The one is that we ban guns entirely, or that we free guns entirely. Those, I think, are the two extremes. I wouldn't advocate for either of those. I think that we need gun control. I think guns are designed for one specific purpose, and that's to kill people. And they are optimized for that. They're highly efficient tools to do that process. And I think, like airplanes, like cars, like everything else, we have to control their use. I think Rowan's right in terms of that it's a great equalizer, but it is also a very efficient tool. And if you use it in the wrong way, you bring about death almost certainly. And I think that's a problem. And I think in any society, you can't have free movement of guns. So you need some kind of control. And I think that that's where the real debate lies, is what is effective control? What are we trying to achieve? Are we trying to stop murder? Are we trying to protect each other? Why is it that we have guns?
So, I mean, I think this whole discussion start, or I think we're having this discussion right now based on obviously a tweet that I posted. I think it was a little over a week ago, that was talking about the mass shootings that were taking place in the United States. And what I was doing is I was just bringing it home based on what our crime statistics are in this country. And the fact that, I see that pattern of the people, their bodies weren't even cold yet, and you had politicians that were spewing the anti-gun law. Not anti, or how can I put it? Not the situation of asking for gun control. It was literally, we need to ban guns, we need to get rid of that. So I suppose context was a bit missing there because a lot of people misinterpreted it. But I do think that it's a discussion that we need to have, in the fact that if you look at crime statistics in South Africa, we literally are a war zone. We've got 57 murders a day, close to 20,000 people dying every year. There's a loose number being thrown around that 23 out of the 57 murders that take place is related to gun, or guns have an impact in that. My argument, I suppose, that I would make is that if we had people that, or more people that armed themselves, criminals would be more wary of the fact that, that house that they break into is an easy target, from the way that I would see it. So, Gary, what do you have to say about this? And then I'll hand over to Ron.
So, Ronaldo, I mean, I speak from a conflict resolution perspective. I've mediated many conflicts, and a lot of that has been crowd control between cops and crowds. And I know that for a fact that every time you introduce a gun into that situation, it escalates the tension, and it makes it far more difficult to resolve the conflict. Now, for cops, I mean, it's a very effective mechanism to calm a crowd. Being shot with a rubber bullet tends to make you rethink your priorities. They are dangerous. They are dangerous things. The argument that a gun is going to make you safer if we arm everyone else, I think, is a very dangerous argument. The problem is that you have no control. You have very little control in terms of who's using that gun. So currently, you have it's people who are interested in owning guns that own guns, and they go through the rigmarole because it's a fairly tough rigmarole. But if you open that up, so I think the estimate is that we have something like over 5 million firearms in the country, of which 3 million are licensed and 2.5 million are illegal. How
That's
they
incorrect.
ascertain that? How they ascertain that? I'm not entirely sure, but. But there is a huge amount of illegal firearms in the country. Do we want to add more guns to that? I think you're adding more fuel to the fire, not taking fuel away.
Okay, Rowan, your response?
Well, so first of all, that number is completely incorrect. I mean, the we've seen figures for illegal firearms in South Africa, touching on 10 million. We're talking about 4.5 million licensed firearms owners in South Africa. Sorry, licensed firearms in South Africa. And, there's simply no way. A huge part of the crime in South Africa is not legal firearms. We've seen it now that the police, latest figure, lost 5,000 firearms in the previous year. 10 million rounds of ammunition that's lost. Not to mention the infamous Colonel Prinsloo case in the Western Cape. Also keep in mind that for in the security company firearms form part of the firearms number under civilians in South Africa. So that's just completely incorrect, that number. The figures that we've seen from places, from in organizations like the CDC in the US just simply show that there's no correlation between higher firearms ownership and higher murder rates. I mean, the murder rate in South Africa and across the world has been in a pretty much a steady decline over the last couple of decades. South Africa specifically, we've seen a steady decline. Then we hit the Firearms Control Act only in 2004, of which we already were in a decline. In fact, we've seen a little bit of an increase in the murder rates just after the Firearms Control Act. Now, I mean, correlation does not equal causation, but I mean, to blame firearms is just simply not correct. We've seen in some of the really pro-Second Amendment, gun-friendly states in the US have some of the lowest homicide rates, and with the reverse being true. So, to put murder and things on something like a firearm, it's just simply not correct.
Okay, sorry, I'm just putting my mic back on. Yeah, so there was a interesting, actually was an article today that came out on My Broadband, which I consider quite reputable, and they had some police statistics that was quite interesting. We in South Africa now have 193,000 police officers, which if you think about it is quite insane. I thought that we had a lot more police officers than 193,000. And that is to patrol what is our population? I think it's 57 million is what we are currently. There is double the amount of private security. We've got close to 500,000 private security as compared to 193,000 police officers. Then there was a study done where they every year these police officers have to go through training, firearm training, and 65% of them failed the fact that they can't shoot three different types of firearms. They can't shoot a 9mm, they can't shoot a automatic, and then they can't shoot a shotgun, which is quite insane. The response time from police officers is also another alarming factor for me. So here's my reasoning, and it's so simplistic, but it's just, if I am at home and my alarm goes off and I know that there's a perp that is going to come in and hurt me and my family, I know that if I have to wait for the private security company, I'm going to wait 5 minutes. If I have to wait for the police, I might wait 30 minutes or more. The fact is, I've got something to defend myself and my family. So, you know, I don't know if the person's got a knife, if he's got a gun, but what I do know is that I've got the very strong means of defending myself. So I'm not bringing a knife to a gunfight. This guy is bringing a knife to my gunfight, if that makes sense, if that takes place in my house. Now, I know that sounds very Rambo, but when it comes to your family and when it comes to your life and your family's life and the fact that, you know, your family members could be potentially raped and murdered, I think it's not extreme. I think it's reasonable to expect that you just fight force with force if it comes to that. And I want to ask, though...
No, sorry, I wanted to add to what you just said, and I thought you were done. My apologies for interrupting you. I made that point in various articles, and I asked it, you know, numerous times. When you take guns away, let's say perfect utopia, we snap our fingers and guns are gone. You nail it. You're the man in the moment. When 2 o'clock tomorrow morning, when you wake up, you are there. Whether you want to be or not, you are the man in the moment. You need to solve that problem that you have. To add your figure, average response time for SAPS in South Africa is about 19 minutes. Fact is, your wife can be gang raped in 19 minutes. So whether you want to be or not, you are the man in the moment. And to this day, none of the anti-gun lobbyist proponents or pro anti-gun people have been able to give a real workable solution to fill that gap, because the reality is the police cannot do it. Last year October, general the name escapes me now, admitted live that the police cannot fulfill the mandate to protect the people in South Africa. So who's left? It's me and you, and as much as Gary likes to admit it or not, it's on you as well. I mean, the police can't do it. On the spot, hell, I work in the security industry, and let me tell you, the standards for the security industry is even lower than the SAPS in some instances. So whether we want to be or not, you're the man. 2 o'clock in the morning, whether you want to be there or not, you're there. And nobody can give an answer what to do if you take your firearm away.
Mm. Yeah, but Rowan, I mean, I think that's a Renata for both you and Rowan. The problem I have is that you're working off an imaginary scenario.
Nonsense.
Okay, just let him finish. Let him finish.
So what you're saying is, what if? So your argument is based on a what if. It's not, what if your gun is there and your child picks it up and shoots themselves? What if your uncle is visiting who's a depressed and shoots themselves? You know, so you, So you can play the game both ways. The question that you're wanting to know is, what do you do in terms of self-defense? Is a gun an effective means of self-defense? And yes, a gun's an effective means of self-defense. But you have to be competent to use it. And by that, you have to be mentally capable of using it in a high stress environment. You have to know how to use your firearm, which means, like the police that you were talking about, that you have regular training. You do it under various circumstances. And then you have to have your gun accessible. You know, so if you... So, Ryan, you say you're the man at 2 o'clock in the morning. Where's your gun at 2 o'clock in the morning?
Right next to me, where it should be.
And do you have children?
No, I do not.
Okay, so the
majority... But that's irrelevant, because all of the legal responsible firearms owners that I know, you know, so I've solved that problem ages ago. And to say we're talking about what ifs, crime is a reality, Gary, whether you like to admit it or not. I mean, it's a reality. And to say preparing yourself for a violent attack is, I mean, sorry, but you're the one living in the fantasy world if you think it's not a reality.
Okay, so let me get in here. Like I said, I'm going to interrupt it when somebody donates. Ande did donate, and he says, oh, I'm going to translate it. He, and this is, I suppose, a good place to enter the humor part. Yeah, he says, I don't need a gun. I just will slap the living shit out of people. No pun intended, which, you know, it's him trolling, but it's a donation. Let me get in here and say, okay, so this is where I'm going to play devil's advocate. We live in South Africa, Gary. We have 57 murders a day. We've got over 100 rapes that happens every single day in this country, right? So we aren't imagining this crime. There's been two instances where my life, according to me, has been saved because of me owning a firearm, right? I was doing oversight. There were perps with knives in their hands. They approached me, and I didn't pull the gun, because everybody has this mentality that you want to be Rambo, right? I didn't pull the gun and shoot rounds in the air and said, hee-haw, you know? I literally indicated that I've got a firearm on me, and I displayed it, and that made the perps run away. Yeah. Now, that is just an example in my life, right? I have to say, though, that if I lived in a very peaceful country with almost no serious crime or murders, I wouldn't want to own a firearm. And I'll tell you why. Because the responsibility of that firearm is quite severe. If I accidentally shoot somebody, in the sense of it going off and ricocheting and hitting somebody, I will go to jail for the rest of my life. So I think that there's a misconception of people... some people, when they hear that somebody owns a firearm, they think that it's a type of person that's literally can't wait to shoot like things in the backyard and shoot at snails or doing something like that. When in actual fact, it's literally just there to defend yourself. Your argument, however, with regards to children, in some cases is a valid argument, but I think it's also very, very limited, in the sense that if you are a responsible legal firearm owner, your gun will either be on you, or if it need be, in the safe, which in my opinion is useless, because a gun in the safe doesn't mean anything. But if
it's still be on the moon.
Yeah, so I think that my devil's advocate that I'm playing here is saying that in South Africa, I think that there's no excuse not to legally own a firearm for self-defense. However, if I was in a different country with low crime stats, I would honestly believe that I don't need it, and I don't want that responsibility. Let's move it to Rowan just to give an opinion on that, and then Gary, you can respond.
Sure.
Well, I want to come back to Gary's, you know, point on if you have children. I mean, we always say you cannot child-proof a gun, but you can gun-proof a child. I mean, there are many young kids who grow up with firearms in the household, and they are never incidents. Nah. The real problem comes in when people try to hide it, and it's some mythical object that you're never allowed to touch, you know. So we've seen... you know, a very good results when children are, you know, made aware of these firearms. I mean, I've got numerous friends who have small kids, and it's not an issue. If that is something that you are seriously concerned about, I mean, there are various mechanical ways where you can make a firearm safe and still have quick access to it should you need it, you know, in like Gary mentioned, should you sleep. I mean, this is a problem that's been solved, you know, many a times over. You know, it's simply a non-issue. In terms of you know, firearms for self-defense, I mean, it's a given. I mean, but I think also a point that Gary made was guns are for killing. That's simply not true. I mean, the sport shooting community in South Africa is huge. I mean, there are so many sporting disciplines where, you know, the guns are not for killing. And quite frankly, you know, just to say you use a gun for self-defense automatically equals killing. Sorry, but I don't buy that. I mean, yeah, us at GOSA, we are all for safe, responsible, legal firearms ownership. We are pro competency training. We are pro getting additional training. We are pro making sure you are a competent firearms owner. We do not believe that it is a be-all and end-all solution for everybody. Not at all. Nah. But we do believe you should have the freedom as an individual to choose if it is the one for you and then accept the responsibility that comes with it. So to share everybody over the same code, it's a Rambo thing, like you said, Ronaldo, or were accused of on Twitter. Yeah, sorry, it's nonsense.
Yeah, Gary.
Okay, so Rowan, I mean, I think I agree with you in terms of the control mechanisms that you guys, and I'm willing to concede that the majority of legal firearm owners in South Africa are responsible firearm owners. But so the scenario that Ronaldo is creating is saying, will we be safer in South Africa if we have more firearm owners? So as in what, doubling the numbers? And I think that we're in a great environment at the moment where you have very strict controls, that the people who want to own a gun can own a gun. They're restricted in terms of numbers and the use that they can use for that. And I think that's a great system. I don't think that's the real problem. The real problem in South Africa is the amount of illegal guns that we have, and the pockets in where they occur. So, you know, in Cape Town, we know the gangs there. The murder rate has increased significantly because there's been more guns in that system. And we, in our own city, in PE, the same thing. And you have, you know, the problem is that you have guns in the hands of teenagers, and the cops can't get to it because the community hides the guns. And I think that's the real problem in South Africa. I don't, in terms of private use and ownership, look, I mean, if you like shooting at a target, I understand that. I've done that many times myself. I don't have a problem with that. But that's not the primary intent of a gun. The primary intent, its sole purpose it was designed for, is for maximum efficiency in terms of harming another object, whether that be an animal or a human. So it's a very effective killing tool, and I'm not trying to slate gun owners by that. I'm not saying that you are Rambos walking down the street, and you're going to shoot everything that moves. You know, I mean, that's not the scenario we have in South Africa. The scenario we have in South Africa is suburbs. Where gangs are running riot, where they control the thing and they have guns, and young teenagers have access to firearms.
If I might add to what you just said, Gary, you talk about the Western Cape specifically. You know, that's kind of a... Oh, sorry, yeah, but you mentioned Western Cape earlier. I mean, Western Cape is actually a massive problem. After the infamous Colonel Prinsloo incident that I mentioned earlier, they say something about like 1,100 murders can be traced to those illegal firearms from one specific source. And that just shows once again, you know, the system as it is now is simply not working. And that's something that we at GOSA are working really hard with and trying to assist, you know, the CFR and the police. Unfortunately, they refuse help most of the time, and yeah, that's a discussion for another day. But the issue is definitely illegal firearms. Gauteng, the Zama Zamas are a huge issue. I was watching a docu by a security, where they talked to a bunch of security company personnel that's trying to deal with this problem. I mean, these guys are facing off illegal miners with belt-fed, full automatic light machine guns. I mean, I mean, just let that sink in for a moment. Sure as hell didn't buy that at your local gun store. I mean, and that's all stuff from illegal arms caches back in the day.
So, let me jump because it's my show. Let me jump in here. I've got an opinion, okay? So my opinion...
We'll give you a chance to talk.
Yeah, thank you. My opinion is that, look, I mean, I have to agree. Like, in a perfect world, a firearm was created to kill. That's it, right? A firearm was created to be efficient in killing somebody. That's why it was created, right?
Yeah.
I agree fully with that. I do, however, think that we are currently... Look... Your point is valid if we lived in an environment where we could literally take all the guns away. Realistically, we will never be able to do that. It's Pandora's box. When that first, when gunpowder was developed and we realized that we can propel objects at the speed of sound or even close to that and kill people, that Pandora's box was open and we're never ever going to close that. The way that I see it is, and this is an opinion, is the fact that if America, as an example, didn't have the gun laws that they have in the sense of everybody being able to arm themselves in their Second Amendment right, then I really honestly believe that crime would be a bigger issue in North America. I believe that it would be more severe. And I think that you can see that in South Africa because it's so hard to obtain a firearm legally in South Africa that it took me, I think it was, and I speak under, my renewal took 5 months to get. My initial one, I think, was between 12 and 15 months before I got my gun license. A lot of people will be deterred by that. A lot of people that's been victims of crime, I feel, might have a limitation in being assessed for a gun license because it might be seen as revenge crime. And thus, they will not be issued their firearm license. That's how I feel. Because I know Rowan will attest to the fact that they don't give reasons as to why they reject your gun license application. You just have to pay all that money again and go through the process once again in order to get your firearms license. So it's really a factor of trying to not get people to own firearms. And I believe that that's problematic. I think that the biggest issue that we have is the police officers that aren't trained efficiently in guns. And secondly, that they need to stop losing their firearms because it's not so much the people that are legal firearm owners that are losing their firearms. It's the people that are actually there to protect us in the first place that are losing their firearms or it being sold, as we saw with the case in Cape Town. Sorry, Gary, you were busy talking.
Look, I hear you, but, we have to learn to walk and chew gum at the same time. You know, it's not that we do only one thing and not anything else. So I think that any complex problem requires a multiplicity of solutions. I understand that the gun owner guys are concerned that we're going to take away their guns. I wouldn't argue for that. I argue for strict controls. I think it sounds very much similar to what Gosa is advocating tonight. Without a doubt in my mind, the gun system in terms of licensing and that is broken in South Africa. It's not working efficiently. It should be working a lot more efficiently. Your concern is that it's taking so long. My concern is that it's not screening out people who are mentally unstable or suicidal. So we know in terms of the case of suicides that if a gun... 85%, I think, is the stat in terms of gun suicides are lethal. It takes a person's life, whereas other suicides are not as lethal because people have the opportunity to opt out. So if you had a screening mechanism that could screen out your mentally unstable, your suicidal people from your good cool-headed individuals who would use it for the purpose that it's intended, then I think it would be fine. But that's, as you say, we don't live in a perfect society.
Before he gets in, because I'll comment from a psychological background, somebody that's got a psychological background. You can be fine today and get your gun license, and in 2 years you can get depressed, you can get suicidal, and you will kill yourself with your own firearm. If there's not a firearm there, you'll find poison, you'll hang yourself, you'll jump off a bridge, you'll find a way to commit suicide if you need to commit suicide. I hear what you're saying with regards that it's not as efficient. And I understand that, you know, if you slit your wrists, your odds of survival are far better than if you had to put a bullet in your brain, to be blunt, but that is what we're talking about here. But I do think
Exactly.
that is a bunch of it's a bunch of woulda, coulda, shoulda, right? At that point in time, no screening method's going to be perfect. However, I believe that the measures in South Africa is far too stringent. If you look at how easy it is to get an illegal firearm, I can go and make a call now and probably get a firearm in 30 minutes. It's not because I know criminals, it's because I know people who know people who know criminals, you know? So it's the same for drugs. I'll fight, drugs are illegal in this country and you can get it faster than what you can get a 2 liter Coke at a shop. So I think the fact is that we have to face a reality that we've got a serious problem, and the way in fighting that is by arming people and giving without compromising on training, without compromising on everything else. But I think that South Africans, legal and competent people, aren't armed enough in order to fight the scourge of crime that we have.
So, Ronald, let me understand correctly. What you're saying is, in our current system, you want to add more guns into the mix, and you're confident that that's going to de-escalate criminal activity. And
Sorry, to answer you, I believe that with more legal and competent people owning firearms in order to defend themselves, I think that crime will go down because of the fact that it's not easy targets. It's not people that can just walk into a house. Because if you're an average criminal, you know that they, well, I don't even think that they think like that, but there's 4 million legal firearms in South Africa. So there are 57 million people living in this country. So you know that on average, you breaking into a house, that person will more than likely not have a firearm. So I think that if.
That's one possibility, yeah. So, but the counter argument to that, Ronaldo, is that that criminal breaking in will arm themselves with better weaponry. So, I mean, if you're talking about that it's easy, you know, so Rowan's point is that you're able to get a heavy submachine gun belt. You know, that criminal has access to networks of far better weaponry than the ordinary average citizen, and all you're doing in terms and from a conflict resolution perspective, is that all you're doing is that you're just escalating, you're escalating the tension and the conflict. And so if you add a gun to the mix, the criminal is going to add two guns to the mix, or a submachine gun to the mix. Now, you know, so
But
you
what's the
can get in.
alternative?
Well,
The alternative, there's many alternatives.
let Rowan jump in here just to counter some of the arguments there.
Okay,
Sure.
so there's three things. To add to your earlier point, the CFR is a mess. They admitted that they have no set standard to allow or disallow firearms licenses. It's a thumb suck, and depending on the mood of the individual in the day. Said, done, over and done with. In terms of the mental aspect that you mentioned earlier, I mean, you already, when you apply for your competency, you have to give references, whether you are, inverted commas, mentally stable, family, friends, wife, etc. So there is a measure of that already in place in the licensing process. In terms of Gary's point, I also, what's the alternative? I mean, to beg, hope, I mean, what people don't realize is that these people are already breaking the law. The laws that's supposed to protect you as an individual are already in place. They are breaking it. So to rely on them not to kill you is to rely on the mercy of a person that's already breaking the law. There's no logic to it at all. I mean, so the alternative is you have to beg and hope and pray. That's the alternative if you don't fight back. We have seen many instances where a person that has less, I do not want to use the word, but inverted commas, firepower, have been successful in fighting heavily armed attackers. It does happen. So, I mean, very infamous cases, the St. James Massacre in the 90s. I mean, it was five heavily armed attackers against one man with a revolver. And in fact, Charles van Wyk was one of the founder members of GOSA. But so, it's not. There is a practical element to it, and at the end of the day, what's the alternative? And then that brings me back to the point I made earlier. One needs to accept that it can happen to you. It might happen, not might, it can happen to you. It will, in all likelihood, happen to you. I mean, Ronaldo, you've used your firearms. I've had to rely on mine. I do not want to discuss it in detail, but I've been in a similar situation. And I've got three friends that are alive today because they were armed. So fact is, it happens. And to just, okay, oh, but, you know, it escalates and escalates and escalates. And that's, what's the alternative?
Just to get in here, before you get there, the people that donate to this chat gets preference over all of you. Werner de Brain just donated, and then he said, alternatively, quadruple the police force. Thanks for the donation, Werner. I do think, though, that that is, look, if we talk just numbers, it doesn't help if you increase the police numbers. What helps if you have competent police officers that can do the job. Now, I really do. I mean, I meet with the police once a week, and they are fantastic officers out there that go above and beyond. Unfortunately, like that is the case with South Africa, there's a few good guys that have to carry the weight of everybody else. And that the number is staggering, 193,000 police officers that have to represent and protect and fight for 57 million people in this country. It's never, ever, ever going to end well, especially if you look at the crime statistics of South Africa. Sorry, Gary, over to you.
Yeah, no, so Ronaldo, the question is what is the alternative? And from a psychology perspective, we have survived as humans through three strategies. One is we fight, and that's what Rowena, as I understand, is suggesting. The other one is that we freeze, and the other one is that we flee, is that we run away. So, I mean, all three of those have been with us as humans since we've existed, which means that those strategies are successful. Now, it varies from situation to situation. You can't anticipate every situation, but you know, if I believe the guys that work in the security industry, security is about layers. It's like an onion, is that you build layers around you. So you have fences, you have electric fences, you have alarms, you have dogs, you have stuff on your gates, etc. And depends on where you live. If you live in PE, you don't possibly need it as much as you do in Gauteng or somewhere else, you know. So it is environmentally specific. If you live on a farm, for instance, you'll probably have higher security because you're more isolated. So there are layers to that. There's no doubt about that. The concern that I have is that we can't, that the gun-free guys, the guys that want guns, don't have an answer for me in terms of the child, the suicide person, in terms of how you prevent them from getting access to guns. And how do you stop that child that wasn't properly trained or is visiting a friend, has seen a TV show, emulates what happens on the TV, and then has tragic consequences. And you know, so I mean, the unfortunate thing for us is that we don't have the stats of how often all of those incidences take place. You know, so Rowan can say, look, three of his mates their lives have been saved. I can, you know, do we measure how often a conflict situation de-escalates? We don't, you know, because you don't go to the police. You don't say, outside the pub, the guys, you know, they just blixtmed each other. They didn't shoot each other. From my perspective, you have to look at multiple factors terms of it. Gun control is one of those. So I don't agree that we take guns away, but I do think that we do need strict controls.
So before Rowan gets in here, just to further my point, because you did ask earlier, do I think that more guns will solve the problem? And there was I did raise an interesting point, if I say so myself, with somebody that said, you know, they would rather have one person with a gun than two people or more, you know, so the lower the gun amount, the better. My argument to that would then be, so let's say you've got one person with a firearm with 100 rounds that's very good at shooting, right? There's 100 people in front of him and he can kill all 100 of them because he's the only one with the firearm. Now you've got two or three people with a firearm, one baddie and two good guys, and they only have 20 rounds on them and they're also good at shooting. So instead of having 100 victims, what you have is you've got now people that are competent and better at defending themselves, and they shoot that perp before he can kill all 100 people. That's a case of more than one gun being able to assist. And I don't want to make reference to mass shootings because once again, it's would have, could have, should have. But I do believe that if more people, if there were more good guys with firearms in a shopping center, when that one guy comes with his full-blown power force to go and blow up a place, I would rather want more people that are legal firearm owners than nobody with a firearm. And that is why areas like gun-free zones really annoy me personally, because a shopping mall that puts gun-free outside is all good and well, because all law-abiding citizens won't take their guns inside, but the legal guy, illegal guy that's there to break in, he's not going to be deterred by that sign. He's going to go in with that AK-47 that he stole, and he's going to blow up the place. That's what's going to happen. So, you know, it's just once again my opinion on that.
Sure. So, but let's not talk hypotheticals. I mean, in the latest mass killing in America, the guy that I think killed 9 people, if I'm not mistaken, he was confronted, taken down within 30 seconds, if I understand correctly. Police officers confronted him within 30 seconds. And I think in that period, he hurt something like 45 people. I mean, I don't know the stats exactly, but it's instructive. You know, the problem is not the good guy in the being in the shopping mall when the guy with the AK-47 walks in. The question is, what happens to that guy with the gun? He's carrying that gun the entire time. So he's going to be in very, very different circumstances. Now, can you assure me that that good guy with the gun, when his mate goes to the bar with him and they're in the pub and they get pissed, and his mate picks up the gun and shoots some other guy, can you know? So if you know, in science fiction, you have this thing where your trigger is triggered by your fingerprint. You know, if you had that kind of technology, I'd be interested. But you don't have that kind of technology. A gun doesn't know who's firing it. It does what it's designed to do, and that's fire a bullet at high speed at whatever it's aimed at. If it hits that thing and it happens to be softer than the bullet, well, then it creates damage. You know, so can you control it outside of that supermarket?
Well, I'll okay, hand so it to Rowan. Yeah.
There's a lot of misinformation in this last 2 minutes. So, first thing, a mall is not a gun-free zone. A gun-free zone needs to be gazetted in the government gazette, and the mall is not a gun-free zone. They can put up a sign. That's a suggestion at best. They can politely ask you to leave should they see your gun. That's pretty much the extent of it.
That was his bit of misinformation, huh?
At least I had one for tonight, right? I'm helping you here. I'm helping you. So that's the first thing. Second thing, that funny enough, the whole biometric firearm fingerprint thing has been tried. It was an epic failure of note. If you have any more advanced firearms training, which I'm not going to go into now, then you'll understand why it won't work. Guns don't jump up and kill themselves. Why would your buddy in the bar just pick up your gun, in your own words, and shoot somebody? Yeah, why? It's not
because
why would your gun be on the counter?
Because we know that is where the majority of murders take place. Is alcohol induced murders that happen in ordinary streets. So we have two gun problems in South Africa. One is guns owned by gangs, and that's illegal guns in terms of how they're getting it, whether it be one individual or across borders or stealing from him. We don't know the exact stats, but we know that they're getting illegal guns somehow. The other problem we have is in terms of ordinary murders that take place in our country, and it is alcohol induced very often. It is 90% of people killed by guns are men. It's men shooting men. Now, in what circumstances is this? You know, I mean, so if you can say to me that gun will only select the person that deserves to be shot, then I'd say to you, that's fine. But you, as you've said yourself, that technology doesn't exist. It's been an abysmal failure. You can't control the bullet once it's fired.
Okay, so just to jump in here. Werner De Bruyne asks a valid question. Thanks for the donation, Werner. I appreciate it. He asks, what are the consequences of successfully defending yourself? And let's say you killed the attacker, etc., and followed all gun rules. Do you have a record? Does this impact your ability to migrate? Let's ask, I just want to ask that for the gun owner's representative here, because he'll know.
Okay, no, I mean, the legislation is very clear on it. You're legally allowed to defend yourself. There's no question about it. This whole thing where you will get immediately arrested and go to jail without passing go is nonsense. It doesn't work like that. There will be an investigation, they will open a docket, etc., 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 but this rifle fire myth that you will be miraculously whisked off to jail without any due process is, yeah, sorry, that's just nonsense. Everybody goes, there is a process if it were to happen, but you are very much allowed to defend yourself or another person. So yeah, don't stress about that. If the situation were to warrant you using, you know, your firearm, do what you need to do. No, if your wife were to use your firearm in an attack where you were shot or killed or whatever, she will not go to jail, neither will you. So don't drink all that Kool-Aid. It's a lot of nonsense, it's a lot of myths. Yeah, short answer, no, you'll be fine.
So also then, just to jump in on this aspect, I, Gary, here's the thing, right? I understand the frustration and I understand the skepticism with regards to being a responsible gun owner. But that is also just like you accused me of creating a fictitious situation. It's pretty much the same because we don't know the stats, right? What I do know is that there are 57 murders a day in this country. What I do know is that we are a very, very violent society. I do know that. And what you say is right. The 90% of crime committed in this country is by men, on men, or to men, men are the victims. That is the majority of crime. The thing though is that I don't think that that's reason enough for me to say, you know, what about that child that we don't know whether or not it actually happens or not? Because I have to say that the anti-gun guys are trying really, really hard to push this narrative that majority of legal firearm owners are irresponsible, or that the chances of a child being shot or somebody shooting themselves with their own firearm. There was an advert recently that came out where they tried to portray that narrative that you are more likely to die at your own firearm or at the hands of your own firearm. And I mean, that was proven false by Africa Chick. Now I know Africa Chick, I know. But the study that was done already says it all, because it wasn't even done. The study wasn't even done in South Africa. So I just believe that based on the statistics that we have, I feel safer knowing that I'll be able to fight force with force if it comes to that. Because according to our law, if somebody breaks into my house and they pose no real danger to me, I'm not allowed to shoot that person. If I shoot that person and my life was not in imminent danger, I can go to jail. And Rowan can correct me, but I do believe that you need to make sure that your life is in imminent danger. And if that person has a knife and you've got a firearm, but he wants to attack you and kill you, then you are well within your right to defend yourself and your family. But I don't think, though, that, and it boils back to the fact that I think that the onus is on legal firearm owners to make sure that it doesn't get to that point where you end up in jail. And unfortunately, as much as what Ron said with regards to the question that the person asked, I do think that it's a massive liability, because the onus is then on you to prove that you defended yourself and that this person was posing a risk to you. So there's a massive responsibility that comes with owning a firearm legally. And I do think that 99% of legal firearm owners in South Africa understand that risk, because the risk is real that they can be impacted. But Rowan, I'll hand over to you.
Yes, I'm chomping at a bit to come in on this real quickly. I mean, that campaign you mentioned earlier was the biggest farce I've seen regarding the whole gun debate in a long time. I mean, it's called Gun Safe Cities. And it was started by Avaaz Joburg, which is a Joburg-based media company. Their resident talking head is a guy called John Davenport. And they push this whole thing that you are four times more likely to injure yourself or another person with your own firearm. So there was so much wrong with this. First of all, they shot this at a shooting range in Joburg under false pretenses. They got caught out on that. Then that figure was actually debunked by the researcher who did the original study. It was already in 2014. Africa Check was actually a little bit behind the curve on that. We as Ghosts, I challenged Havas on that multiple times, including myself. I've challenged John Davenport to a debate numerous times. He's ignored me like a stop street on a gravel road.
That's a good one. I'm sorry, that was cock funny. I have to say that was cock funny.
Recently, the Havas guys came in. They are now finished with the gun debate, because you got caught in a lie. And then I challenged them again, asking if they're now going to issue an apology for their lie, and they did not do that either. So, and I'm really disappointed that he did not respond to your request for a debate, because I do believe you did invite him.
He did respond, and he said he's not interested in the discussion anymore because he believes.
Exactly.
With all due respect, I mean, I'm just reporting what he said. I'm not here. He's not here to defend himself, but I gave him the opportunity to.
I'll stop now.
No. But what he said was he said that he's no longer interested in the discussion because it's proven not to be fruitful to have a discussion around gun control in South Africa. That is pretty much what he responded.
Because he got caught out.
Okay, well, yeah. Sorry, so that was a response.
But okay, beside the point. That whole thing is a complete lie. I mean, it's been thoroughly debunked. If anybody is really keen to read up about it a bit more, Paratus, which is a very prominent gun blog run by a GOSA member, has got a lot more info on that. Don't drink that Kool-Aid.
Gary?
So Rowan, I mean, as Ronaldo's made the point that the majority of gun owners are responsible people, if we accept that, I think we then have to accept that people that are concerned about gun control are also responsible people. So you have a case here where you've had an ad flighted that Africa Check has debunked and other people, the original researcher, have debunked. That's what should happen, is that if you put false advertising out, you should debunk it. It should be banned. You should be banned, whatever be the case in terms of it. But what it doesn't do is it doesn't change the facts and the issue that we are faced with. You know, so how do we stop gangs getting guns? How do we stop guys who want to commit suicide using guns? How do we stop kids getting access to guns? Now, are there solutions to those? Those are the things that I think that we need to talk about, and we need to talk about it sensibly. I don't speak for the guys who did the ad. I don't know who they are. I don't know who this guy is that doesn't want to debate you, but here I am. I'm willing to debate you.
No, fair enough.
So we can have a discussion, you know, but I mean, I'm not throwing things at you. I'm not accusing you of anything. I'm not saying that you want to kill babies or anything like that. You know, what I'm saying is that and I agree with you, Noel, I mean, South Africa is a specific situation. It's very high crime. It's a very violent society. Our real problem is that we kill each other far too often, you know, and that we use various means to do it. Now, in terms of the data, my understanding is that guns are involved something like 35% of the time. It's come down. The standard is something like 40%. So we're doing well in South Africa. I mean, so that could be because we now have responsible gun owners. You know, we know that women being shot or women femicide by their partners has come down significantly. It used to be 4 every day. I think it's now 3 every day. And people reckon that's because of the gun control stuff that we place. You know, so I think the majority of society is not the guys that have created this ad that used false information. The majority of the society is saying, look, we've got some serious problems that we need to find ways to talk about. And we need to stop we need to be able to find ways in which we can talk to each other. So that's why I'm here, is from gun owners, how do you stop kids getting access to those guns? How do you stop a suicidal guy from using a gun? How do you stop the gangs getting those guns that they're using at the moment? That's where I think the debate should be. The debate on mass killings in the U.S. is an interesting intellectual argument for us in South Africa. It's not a reality for us. The mass killings that happen in our society are done by police. You know, that's Marikana. You know, Marikana is very clear. We know how they could have stopped it. They issued live ammunition. They should never have issued live ammunition. You know, so we know those kind of scenarios. So how do we become more responsible society? How do we deal with guns? We can't ban guns. You know, there's farmers there that need the damn things, because for various things. You know, guys like Germ that like shooting targets. I mean, you know. He should be allowed to continue doing that. I don't have a problem with that, you know. Mm. But I'd prefer he would be using a Vumbux and not an M15, an AR-15, you know. Yeah. So
I'm very proud that that was my firearms he shot. So I am. Oh, wow. I'll take some of that guilt if guilt is. No. So Gary, I actually agree with you. To just touch very, 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 very briefly on the mass shootings in the U.S. and kind of how it ties in with your point about, you know, mental issues. There's been, if you look at some of the information that's available, there is a definite trend that you see in amongst these individuals that, you know, go down that route. There's a definite indication for mental issues, depression, bipolar, medication, etc. A big indicator is broken homes, households, single parent households, absent fathers. You know, there's a lot of socioeconomic factors that contribute to that. And then one need to ask yourself, you know, what isn't the problem somewhere else? You know, is it not why is it a gun problem if there are other issues that lead up to it? And then what your point about the depression and things, and that's the trends that we see in some of the people that perpetrate some of these mass shootings. But so yes, there are definite indicators, and there needs to be looked at these things. I mean, I'm fully, you know, in agreement with you on that, because these are indicators. So, but also keep in mind that it's outliers. It's such a small percentage of the overall number of gun owners.
Ron, I mean, just to come back to you, you know, and I, you know, I mean, I we have fun on Twitter in terms of arguing about the mass things happening in the States. I think that's a problem the States has to solve for themselves. In South Africa, the question to you as the gun owners of South Africa would be, is that we have a community here, Bethelsdorp, where you have teenagers walking around with guns. How they got those guns, we're not entirely sure, but they are teenagers and they initiate themselves into their gangs by using those firearms. Those firearms are hidden by members of the community, so you do a house-to-house search, the guns come back. How does gun owners in South Africa make that neighborhood a safer place?
Okay, so before you answer that, another super chat donation from Shane. So keep that in mind, but I want to thank Shane for the generous donation. He just said, great debate. As an avid, competent gun owner, how do we stop people shooting first and asking questions later if there are more guns in the hands of incompetent owners? Which I will hand over to, just to tie in maybe with your question or your answer, Rowan, if you don't mind.
Okay, if I forget your answer, then just remind
me. I'll remind you.
So from us at GOSA, a big part of our whole strategy, if we can call it that, is education in terms of firearms specifically. You know, we do various firearms festivals where we work with members of the community, where they are free to come in, ask questions, shoot guns in a safe environment, clear up myths, women, children, you know, and it's open to anybody regardless of race, creed, you know, whatever, you know, all the demographics, you know, it's open to anybody. So to clear up a lot of these myths and to educate people. So that's a huge part of what we do, and it's costing us a ridiculous amount of money to do that. In terms of socioeconomic factors in low-income communities, one needs to ask then, you know, that's not a GOSA issue. And as far as I'm concerned, that is very much a government function to do education, to help these communities, job creation, poverty, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And there's a definite trend amongst lower income communities and violence. So then one needs to ask, you know, is it a gun issue, or is it a socioeconomic issue? So, you know, one needs to look at that. But I think for the government to go after the guns specifically it's a plaster over a gunshot wound, excuse the pun, but it's not going to solve the problem. It will just move the issue to broken bottles and knives. So you can't paint over a house if the foundation isn't right. And it's a bit of a philosophical long-term solution, but it needs to go down that way. Otherwise, you're never really gonna stop the issue.
So if we can just come back to the socioeconomic things. The socioeconomic things, we know that violent societies, there are a number of common factors. Inequality is one of those. And what happens is that poverty is then concentrated in specific communities. Now, that's South Africa for us. We also know that our society has been a violent one since basically its conception. It has been violent. We have used various tools to kill each other in that process. We know that murder rates since the 1950s have been at this kind of level that it is at the moment. You know, so I mean, I think the question to you as gun owners of South Africa is that you have now said to me that the gangs in the northern areas is not your issue, that's a government issue. But you're arguing for laws that make it easier for those gangs to access weapons. Now, you know, and it's the issue I've raised with Germ before, and Germ's, you know, so Germ likes posting these macho things of him and his wife shooting on the gun range, the AR-15. Now, I mean, it's interesting that it's not his AR-15, but it's your AR-15. And so my real concern is I'm not interested in Germ so much. I mean, I think he's a great cartoonist, et cetera, and we have great debates on Twitter. The real issue I have
He's actually quite a cock cartoonist, though. He's the 39th best cartoonist in South Africa, so let's not give him praise.
He's very proud of that.
Yeah. Shane, we haven't forgotten about your question. I will get to it. Sorry.
And there's only 38 cartoonists in South Africa. You know, and he's number 39. So,
exactly.
So the question around to you is this. Is what prevents the gang member's mother buying five firearms and lending them out to the guys within her son's gang?
So first of all, she can't buy five firearms.
Okay, cool.
So that's the first thing. Secondly, from you starting to buy a gun to you actually having your first gun in your hand will take you anywhere between 6 months and a year. That's for one gun. Secondly, each of those guns need to have a motivation to it. And there is limits on the kinds of firearms you can buy according to the current model of the FCA. So unless she's wanting to buy them some hunting rifles, which is really defies the point, you know, it's not going to happen. Also, buying a gun in a gun shop is a very expensive exercise. To buy five guns, we're talking probably in the region of 60 grand once off, you know. So you know, it's a very, very long process that's definitely not gonna work for those guys. They will go after illegal firearms, no doubt.
And then also on top of that is also, if a murder gets committed with that firearm, you can trace it back to the owner, right? Whereas okay, currently with an illegal firearm, maybe it'll trace back to a stolen firearm. So there is more responsibility and accountability with somebody. Like, you need to report your gun missing immediately or stolen. You can't just let it hang in the air and not, because if a crime gets committed with that firearm, at the end of the day, if you didn't report it, you will be held responsible for that. So there are checks and balances in place that actually makes owning a firearm legally more attractive to avoid a prison sentence than if you had to commit it with an illegal firearm. But I just have to get in here because this question still hasn't been answered, and I do think we need to answer it.
Just remind me quick.
It's, how do we stop people shooting first and asking questions later if there are more guns in the hands of incompetent owners? It's a difficult question. It
so,
is.
It is. So maybe can I?
Yeah.
Can I just add to that, and then you can answer? Because it was the key point, and I think that question is one of my concerns. Is the Renato, when you say you want more guns in the society, and I'm assuming that Rowan is your position too. How would you do that without compromising the current gun controls we have in place? You understand the question? So
yeah.
So the question.
How would you? Yeah, sorry.
Yeah. So.
Okay. All right. I follow you. So, part of the current process of buying a firearm is you need to go through the competency process first. That has got two parts. It's got the physical training part of where you need to actually go and shoot the gun. And then there's the legal part when you, it's the current firearms legislation, what is private defense, and. So there's that education part that goes very along with it. Unfortunately, there are some service providers that shortcut that. But once again, then the police and the CFRs must do their jobs. Simple as that. They must clamp down on these. There was actually something on carte blanche about it. So very much they should focus on you know, the quality part of enforcing quality, you know, processes when it comes to the competency training. Very much so. Then, you know, there's the standard checks that come along with you need to motivate the firearm. If you've got a criminal record for certain things, you will not be able to get a firearm. So to kind of think about hypotheticals where just shoot first and ask questions later, with education, following the correct processes, etc., you know, there's the only way you're going to be able to do that. You will always have some idiot somewhere. I'm not denying that, you know, but the same goes for drunk drivers and guys speeding. You'll always have somebody that's going to do something that he's not supposed to do. That's why we have legal processes in place. Then you will face the repercussions for it. And as far as we're concerned from GOSA, if you break the law, face it. You know, if you're not following the regulations, you're just making it harder for me and for Ronaldo to own firearms and making it more difficult. So, you know, there's those processes that are put in place that is supposed to prevent these things from happening. The CFR and the police must do their jobs to make sure that these service providers do what they're supposed to do. Does that answer your question?
Shane does say, I mean, with regards to the criminal shooting first, not someone who is licensed, assuming that the person being robbed has a gun as well. Yeah, I think that gives it, look, I mean, a criminal is going to act like a criminal. I mean, the thing though is there's the fear that people, and I mean, I've seen this where people have come and they said, you know, if criminals know that there's a potential that somebody else might have a firearm, then they are more likely to shoot first and then ask questions later. My argument to that is, well, I can argue that by them knowing that somebody might have a firearm, it would actually deter them from committing that crime in the first place. Neither you nor I have full-on proof for that statement, but I think it's a very circular argument to have to say that, oh, but by having more firearms, it means that people will shoot first and ask questions later. I don't think that that's the case. I think that it'll actually make people second guess whether they should attack somebody because they think that they just easy prey. That's at least my point.
An armed society is a polite society.
Well, I don't know. How does Gary feel about that?
So that's where we do differ. And I mean, why is the Wild West no longer the Wild West? Why, I mean, that was, everyone could have a gun. That should have been a very peaceful society. But
it was actually quite peaceful. Gary, let's talk hypotheticals. Me and you meet each other in the street. We don't know each other from a bar of soap.
Yes.
I see you carrying a gun. You see I'm carrying a gun. Are you going to rave me about it or not? Of course you're not going to try. I mean, so yes, good morning, thank you, and we walk past each other. I mean, if you look at, let's take a real world modern example. Let's take some of your really pro-gun states, your Utah, Arizona, those states in the US. Some of those have open carry laws, but they have some of the lowest homicide rates in the whole of the US. You know, if you're trying to rob somebody and you know there's a very good chance of you being shot, you'll reconsider your life choices very, very quickly.
Yeah, but Rowan, you, I mean, you can't in one hand diss the anti-gun argument that says guns are to blame by using an argument that says that guns are not involved at all. You know, I mean, there's those examples that you use. There's homicide is a multiplicity of factors. It's not just guns, and it's not just stuff. It's how it all combines together. You know, and to answer your question, if I saw you walking down the street, you look a bit bigger than me. You probably are likely to blixer me more, but I think I'm faster than you. I'm going to run away. It's a very successful way of not having conflict. Or I might buy you a beer, you know. Hopefully, yeah, I drink more beer than you.
My point is, Billy, if you've got two guys that just crossing paths, it's two random people, I mean, why would they just shoot one another? It just doesn't make sense. There's no logic to it. I mean, why would you willfully go after somebody that you know is armed?
There's very strong logic to it. And it is my personal experience that in conflict situations, if you add a gun to the mix, the tension rises, escalates significantly in that process.
I don't agree with that let me jump in. Sorry. I don't agree with that because if I see a police officer, then I tend to... I think, yes, there's outliers to this, but I think if I see a police officer, which we all know are armed, I see it as de-escalating the situation on average. Yes, there's definitely cases where it might happen. And it's the same with when I see a bulge on the side. Let me just rephrase that and say it quickly. A bulge on the side, not in the front, because that would be problematic. A bulge on the side will make me think twice about confronting somebody because I put my life and preserve. I want to preserve my life. It's a human instinct that I'm not going to try and cause a situation where I know that I might put my life or my family's life in danger.
You're talking about ordinary citizens there, but the ordinary citizens we know are not the problem. The problem is criminals, and as far as I understand it, criminals are the most experienced in terms of using weapons and intimidation. So they're going to be better than your ordinary citizen in terms of using that.
But that's a problem. That's a problem that we have in South Africa. Is that we have a case of we have people that aren't educated enough to understand the severity of crime. We don't have people that understand the repercussions of said crime. So we have a very vulnerable situation and a vulnerable citizens of this country, because everybody thinks that crime won't affect them until it affects them. Everybody thinks that they won't become a crime statistic until they become a crime statistic. So I think that is why I'm proposing that, you know, I believe that we should arm more individuals legally, because that will then assist them in fighting this surge of crime that we have when it takes place. Because we've got a lot of people breaking into other people's property and killing them, raping them, and doing all of that type of stuff. So for serious crime, I think it's really important that we consider that more people should be armed. That is just, I mean, that no scientific science behind it. It's just my opinion on that. I think that we might have lost Rowan there. I think he might be back.
So Ronaldo, whilst we wait for Rowan, I am deeply concerned by that suggestion, because you can't differentiate between the good guy and the bad guy in our current system. And our system is broken. If it was a good system that was working as GOSA intends it to work, and as the police intends it to work, then maybe you would have a case. But if you're adding more guns into the system, you're not able to give it to the good guys only. You're only going to be able to give it to guys that jump through the hoops, and bad guys get those guns in any way, you know, I mean.
Okay, Rowan, can you hear me? Before you do, though, sorry,
guys.
Azad, welcome back.
Sorry, guys. My apologies.
Is your battery flat?
My battery let me down.
Called it. I just want to thank Herzog now for participating in the super chat. You didn't ask a question, but thanks for the super chat. It's really appreciated. If you have a question, I'll ask it. Otherwise, I'm going to move for a closing argument because we've been already going for an hour and 20 minutes. So I just want to look, I mean, Here's mine. Let me start off by saying that I believe that we don't have a lot of people in South Africa that legally are that's armed, right? And I think that what we're seeing is that we're seeing the crime statistics that we are seeing because of that. I believe that if we actually put the fear back into potential criminals, that would de-escalate the issue and make people second guess whether they're going to rob somebody tonight or murder somebody, because it's so much easier to know that you've got vulnerable people that can't or that are not armed. So my philosophy is that I believe that we should give people the tools to empower themselves and defend themselves, because we currently have a police force that just isn't well resourced, isn't well manned. And that is providing a situation in South Africa that is conducive to crime. I believe that if you look at the statistics of how many people commit crime legally with, or how can I put it, legal firearm owners that commit murders, I don't believe, and that's one thing that I would say that we need. We need proper research done on this, because at the moment, there's a lot of thumbsuck from people that oppose guns, and there's also a lot of thumbsuck, honestly, from people that support arming yourselves. And up until that point where we get proper research done, we're not going to have the answers, and we're going to have arguments like this and discussions, which is great, because I think that it's discussions that we need to have, but it's not conducive to getting a solution, because the points that you raise, Gary, is very valid in the sense of people that obtain these firearms and use it and how that adds to the crime statistics. But I also understand the other point of the argument, which is like we need to defend ourselves. We need to have firearm owners that can prevent criminals from, you know, committing the crimes that they are committing. So that's my take on it. But I will hand over to Gary and then I will hand over to Rowan for the last remarks.
Ronaldo, thanks, and Rowan, thanks for you to you as well. And I think where I would like to see the gun debate going in South Africa is how we make it a society a more responsible society. I don't think that adding more guns into the mix does it. Maybe adding more responsible gun owners into the mix is a better solution. I think adding more guns into the thing, you just add fuel to the fire. You have less control. We are a broken society. We are a violent society, and we have been for many years. That's our key problem. We need to understand that. And so guns doesn't make us a violent society. It's our nature that makes us a violent society. But guns are a very effective tool of then using, of then doing something with that violence. And in most cases, it is fatal. You know, so I'm not saying, okay, let's take away guns and everyone gets a rubber cricket bat or something like that. I'm not suggesting that at all. I think the current controls that we have in place are sufficient. I think our system of operating those controls is broken, and it's not discerning the good guys from the bad guys. And we need to fix that up. I would like to see GOSA talking about how we can be more responsible in society in terms of how do we make those gun clubs better, or the gun dealers better, or the process better. My understanding is that the crime lab in Pretoria that does the ballistics testing has no money at the moment, and so they can't do the costs. I'm not sure how true that is. You know, so if GOSA funded that lab, I think that would be a fantastic way of solving some of the problems that we have. Guns are not the problem. Guns are part of the problem, and we need to find a way, in a responsible way, that allows us not to add fuel to the fire, but take fuel away from the fire. We are a violent society. There are criminals. Criminals are the best users of weapons in our society. They're more skilled at it than the average citizen is. My real interest is a neighborhood that's very close to me. How do I take teenagers? How do I take the guns away from those teenagers? That's where I would I'd like us to focus the debate in South Africa.
Thanks, Gary. Rowan.
Okay, I really hope my internet doesn't let me down again. So from GOSA's side, we have offered help to SAPS, CFR, etc. numerous times. They have yet been unable to play ball with us. In fact, we were constantly forced to face misdirection lies, complete disregard for legal instructions. They don't want help. As much as it pains me to say it, they have no interest in doing that. That's why we are forced to sue them quite regularly with great success. We would love to use that money for something else. Last year we blew R1 million on preventing the police from confiscating the guns from legal gun owners. I mean, where in your world do you have to do something like that? It's ridiculous. But fact is, we had to blow a bar to do it. So we're trying, we've offered help. We have real-time workable solutions that we can offer, but there's just no interest from SAPS and the CFR, which is unfortunate. We would have liked to work with them, but we had no luck. They just love throwing our tax money back at us when they have to pay for the legal costs. But in terms of our position on it is very simple. Everybody needs to make a decision whether they want to be a gun owner or not. Your choice. Whether it's from sport hunting or self-defense, doesn't matter. We don't care. If you don't want to own a gun, that's fine. That's your choice. It's your decision. If you feel it's not for you, then, you know, no skin off our backs. We just want the courtesy to be left alone to make that decision for ourselves. We are pro competent gun owners. We are pro safe gun owners. We are pro responsible gun ownership. You know, we do not believe in it must be a complete free fall. So, you know, that's our position on it. Leave us to make our decisions, and we leave each other alone. The problem is that we have organizations and that are, in our opinion, pushing a narrative with an agenda, and that is dishonest. But that's a discussion, you know, for another day.
Yeah. Just so, in conclusion.
In conclusion, from our side, we're pro-responsible firearm ownership, and we're open to discuss it with the various bodies, and we just want that freedom to make that decision for ourselves.
All right. Just also to ask Gary and Rowan, where can people follow you? So let's start with Rowan, and then Gary can end it off.
Our Facebook is GOSA, Gun Owners of South Africa. It's very well managed, and I can with confidence say all the information you will get on GOSA is very well checked by the legal team and a very strong admin team. And another great source is Paratus, which is a local gun blog. Which is very heavily supported by GOSA. Both have Facebook and websites.
All right, Gary.
So you can find me on Twitter and occasionally in the columns in our local newspaper, The Herald. But if you follow me in the shopping mall, you probably find that I might be a bit opposed to that and ask the SAPS to intervene in that situation.
Or you can call a legal file on it.
19 minutes, Gary.
Yeah, 19 minutes, if you're lucky.
Big shopping centers here in PE, you know.
It's probably 25 minutes or exactly. An hour.
Although, can I just, before we go, just one thing totally unrelated.
Yes.
In our city today, Banyana won the Kofsa final. So well done to those ladies. Fantastic. I think we should all start supporting women's soccer rather than men's soccer and men's rugby, as interested. Well, although the Bokke did very well.
I wanted to say, well done. They won in Nelson Mandela Bay today. They played at the Wolfson Stadium. So, all right. So, thank you so much, guys. I really do appreciate it. I will. What I'll do is I'll do my little bit at the end now. But I want to say thank you. So Gary is on Twitter. I think it's Gary22, I believe.
Yeah. And Gary K22.
And then obviously Rowan and the guys from Gun Owners South Africa on Facebook, and I believe you're also active on Twitter there with GOSA, but people can find you on there. Thank you very much. I really do appreciate you guys coming on and forming part of the discussion. Gary, it's always interesting to have you on. You are more one of the few people on the moderate to far left that I actually enjoy having on this show, so thank you. And then Rowan, obviously biased here as a legal firearm owner. I love the work that you guys do, and thank you, and please continue to keep on doing so.
Yeah, no, Gary, thanks to you for your time. I will admit, I prepped myself for more of a fight, but I think we were quite civil to one another. Yeah.
Yeah,
and Ronaldo, once again, from Gosa's side, thanks for your support. You know, second time we've been on. Yeah, and thank you for always giving us the opportunity to have our say.
It's only a pleasure. And good luck with that beard. Once you get to my status, then, you know, I think you can show off. Gary also got a solid old toppy beard there, so well done. It's a bearded mess tonight on the show. Just from my side, I'd like to just congratulate Brad Binder also on winning the Moto2 race today, and then the Springboks for winning the Rugby Championship, and then, as Gary mentioned, for Banyana winning, I think it's that's the championship that they form part of. Yes, there we go. So congratulations to our sporting codes for doing really well, and then obviously for Brad Binder doing a fantastic job. And yes, guys, to end off the stream, please be sure to hit that like button. Also, please be sure to subscribe to my channel, and to everybody that tonight contributed through the super chat or being a member of my channel, I really do appreciate it. And you know, it's fantastic that this new initiative from YouTube has been created, where people can contribute like that. So that's pretty much all I've got to say from my side. Gary, once again, thank you. Rowan, thank you very much. And I'll see you guys in the week for a new video. Otherwise, you can catch me on Wednesday for the live show, and next week Sunday for a Sunday debate. That's pretty much all I got to say. Till later, cheers and peace out.